of strength and healing. And I've gotten to the other side. I'm able to share a piece of redemption or wisdom. But tonight I'm standing here as a very fragile person. So when I was 7 years old, I was a scrappy kid. I'm still a scrappy kid, but back then, when I was seven, my brother and I, he's younger, we were standing in the front yard playing. And I'm standing in front of the flagpole in our front yard, and I'm looking up at it, and the thought that comes to my head is in what was known as gym class, right? The rope that goes all the way up to the ceiling where they put a 2-inch pad underneath and they say, climb up. So that's what I thought I could do. So I shimmied right up that flagpole without a problem, got to the top. I'm looking around, I'm thinking, this is really cool. My brother's at the bottom, his eyes are this big, he's like, wow. And so then I'm like, okay, well, it's time to come down. And I look down, and I think of fire department, right? The pole there. I'll just slide right on down, and everything will be fine. There is one critical difference between flagpoles in your yard and fire department poles, and those are the hooks. So I slide right on down, and sure enough, I get stuck. And I'm not talking about a piece of clothing. I'm talking about the hook went and gutted me right into my stomach. I actually kind of hung there for a second and figured out, well, this isn't good. So I went up a little bit, unhooked myself, and went back down. I got to the bottom, and I lifted up my shirt, and sure enough, there was a hole in my stomach. And my brother panics. And he's like, you have to go in and tell mom and dad. And I put my shirt down, I'm like, no, I'll be fine. So I hobble around the front yard for I don't know how long, and my mom comes out to run an errand. She's getting into her car, and she looks at me, and she says, what's wrong? Nothing. Court, you're acting funny, what's going on? I'm fine. Minutes go by, and I finally lift up my shirt, and hole is there and bleeding. And she panics, because she usually passes out at the sight of blood, so she ushers me into my dad's where he patches me up. And I want to share that story because there are hundreds of them just like that, from when I was little all the way up until right now, where I make a poor decision. And I'm so ashamed that I have made a stupid choice. That I hide it, I cover it up, I don't tell anyone, I try to figure it out on my own. And you know, you allude to the Enneagram one. It's part of that. I think it's part of because even the good labels that are put on you are not so good. I have been labeled my whole life as smart, brilliant, wise, 1 point shy of genius. My whole life. And so when I make a bad decision, I carry that shame like a blanket. I wrap it up, I even put on a little hat and booties, and I go on my merry way. Because I don't want people to know that I made a bad choice. So you can imagine, with all the stories you do know about me already, you know, how that has shown up in my life over and over again. About 5 years ago, I stood on the stage for the very first time next to my husband to talk about our marriage crisis. And afterwards, I was out there at the table selling my book, and Suzanne Straub, TEDx speaker, icuTalks speaker, wonderful, wonderful person, she bought my book, she read it. And a few months later, I saw her again, and she came up to me, and she said, I read your book, it reads just like a movie. And when she said that, something stirred. Because you see, if you know my story at all, you know that God told me that I was going to share my story with thousands. And he had already shown, step by step, how he was opening doors, and each time I walked through, it was a wider audience. It went from small groups at church, to large groups at church, to being on the big screen at church, two churches, to a book, and then on to 700 Club a couple years ago. And so when Suzanne said that and something stirred, I thought, this is God's promise unfolding. Now, I didn't want a movie. The story that my husband and I share is not something good. I mean, you promised me years ago, at that time, 7 years ago, that I was going to share my story with thousands. And here I am, standing in the mall, shopping, and I'm getting a message about someone who wants to make my book into a movie. Like, that is beyond what I could imagine. Then I called my husband, and he's like, what? We talked, we prayed, we met with the filmmaker, we invited him to our house, we met him for lunches, and over the course of several meetings, he was a Christian filmmaker, had done a couple movies, had done a couple made-for-TV movies, had worked in the Christian film business, and he saw our vision. He saw our vision of ensuring that that Mark was not made out to be evil or an enemy. He saw our vision of fulfilling God's promise to me that he was not going to let our story just wither away, and that we had walked through it not in vain, but with purpose. And so we prayed about it, and we decided to move forward. And I wanted to learn how to screenwrite too, so he promised to teach me as we went along. Well, a couple months go by, and all of a sudden there's budgets, and there's talk of lots of money, and there's talk of actors. I mean, everyone, you know, the big joke is, who would play you in a movie? Well, we were having those conversations, and the names that were being thrown out, they were exciting, very exciting. So as we took a step back, my husband and I, we would walk every night. We would walk and we'd pray, and I'd walk by myself 45 minutes every day in a prayer walk, every single day. God, keep my head on straight. Keep my head on straight. Because I see dollar signs, and I don't care about that. I care about your promise to me. I care about being a part of the bigger kingdom picture. What you're doing in marriage and addiction and redemption, I want to be a part of that. Don't let me see the numbers. I don't care. I really don't. So my husband and I actually met with a pastor at our church to help keep us in the rails. And it happened to be Jeff. You'll hear from him later. And it was great. We sat and we talked, and we said, you know, it's really exciting. We just want to make sure that we're not getting outside God's will. And so we continued to pray, and a couple months went by, and there was still no screenplay. And we started asking, you know, what's happening? You know, the timelines keep going. And he said, don't worry, I actually have an investor. And he emailed the investor and copied us, and I thought, gosh, we're part of this amazing industry. I just, you know, this is bigger than anything I've been a part of. My husband and I were sitting on the back patio one night, and I just started crying, and my husband's like, what's wrong? Do you want to not do this? You want to stop? And I'm like, no, these are tears of absolute joy, because I had never felt so close to God. I had never felt walking step by step by step alongside God. I never felt that. I felt like it was in the Garden of Eden, and I was right there with him, and it was magical. And it brought tears. I felt so blessed. I felt this was the biggest gift. I mean, when you walk out your calling, when you walk out your purpose, there's no greater thing on this earth. So, again, delays happened, and I knew it was part of the industry. And so, you know, and there were always reasons. He sent us pictures of him in the hospital. He had an eye infection. And then he revealed to us that, actually, this was a personal story for him. It was hard for him to write the screenplay because it was hitting home that this is actually his story. And so my husband and I started ministering to him. And we thought, this is incredible. I mean, this is a Hollywood guy. And he's revealing hurts, and his faith is broken, and we're ministering to him, you know. Months go by again, and now it's been 6 months. We were supposed to have our screenplay in 2. And all of a sudden, we lost touch. This guy never contacted us. And we got suspicious. So, we more. Now, during my daily prayer walks with God, to keep my head on straight, it was always me talking. And I would listen and listen and listen, and I would say, God, as this wore on, and all of a sudden there was no screenplay and we're still waiting, I said, God, do you want us to back out? I said, is it the money? Are we not thinking about this the right way? Is this a, you know, some type of, are we making a bad decision, right? And there was silence. There was absolute silence. And I remember reading Dallas Willard's book called Hearing God. I did it with a Bible study with friends. And it's a really difficult book to read. Because a lot of it was over my head. But what I do remember about it was that when God is silent, it's not because he isn't there. It's because you already know him. You know his character. You know what he wants. You just have to live it out. Just walk, keep walking. And so I did. I kept walking. I kept praying. I kept not hearing him. I took that as a sign as everything was fine. Well, time went on and we still hadn't heard from him, so we actually asked him for a refund because it was playing with the rest of our lives. We were getting crazy. You know, we couldn't work, we couldn't sleep, we didn't know what was happening. It was driving us nuts, and quite frankly, it wasn't worth it. What we were gonna miss the most when we decided to back out, what we were gonna miss the most was we had planned to make sure that we were keeping our heads on straight. We had planned to sit down with our pastors at church and hand them a big check and say, here, take it. We don't want it. And that was what I was gonna miss the most, is being able to do that. But it was becoming a problem in our life. It was consuming us. So we tried to back out, and the screenwriter said, sure, no problem. He set up a refund in the banking system, and then the day before it was supposed to clear, he canceled it. And we contacted him, he said, you know what, I'm sorry. I really want to do this. This is going to make a big difference. Just give me another chance. And we did. Because that's what we're called to do. We're called to forgive. That's what we thought we were doing. So 7 months later, we hadn't heard from him again. This time we asked for a refund and there was none. So I reached out to the person who had connected us and I said, hey, have you heard from this filmmaker? And her reply, it was last year on December 28th. Her reply was immediate. Oh no. What's oh no? She said, I thought maybe he was gonna do you right, but we found out he's a con man. What? She gave me the name of another filmmaker, and we talked, and it turns out that my husband and I were one of over 2 dozen victims. And, you know, I've been betrayed in this world quite a few times by people. And I'm not surprised when it happens anymore. It may sound jaded, but it hurt. It stunk. It was a lot of money. But I was able to spend a couple months and work through that and forgive this person. He had used our faith against us. He had used God, and not just his name, but his character, our story. He had betrayed us to the core, not just financially, but spiritually. And over a couple months, we were able to forgive him and move on. It's just money. But what I couldn't move on from was the betrayal I felt from God. I remember sitting in my bedroom window, in my bedroom looking out the window, and I was so angry. because I remember my words, and I remember hearing them thinking, oh, you sound like, you know, like you don't have any faith at all. You should know one thing. My spiritual gift is faith. So when this story unfolded, and when the enemy took a hold of our story, and when he twisted God's promise for me, and when he used this, actually what ended up being an addict and con man, to wiggle into our lives again and to open up our hearts again and to remind us of this story again and to dive deep into it, get our hopes up, and to think that I was walking alongside God. What the enemy had done was hit, was strike at the core of my spiritual gifting, which is my faith. And I remember looking out my bedroom window thinking, God, you forsake me. You forsook me. I don't know what the proper grammar is, and I'm a grammar person. Oh gosh, I felt so abandoned and so betrayed, not by this human being, but by God. I felt like he had promised me things. He had grown that seed in me. He had planted ideas and vision. And I had prayed. I remember thinking, God, I did everything right. We did everything we could. We were going to give the money away. We went to our pastors to make sure we didn't get our heads too big. We made sure that our marriage was strong enough to tolerate something like this. I prayed. I spent time with you for 45 minutes every single day, walking and praying and listening. You weren't there. I begged you. I know you can speak to me because you've done it before. I've heard you. You've rescued me. You saved me. You spoke to me in the deepest and darkest places of my life. Why not now when I was asking you for answers? Why not now? He was still silent. I still didn't hear a thing. And I remember thinking, we sing songs. We just sang a song about God not forsaking us. But then why did Jesus on the cross ask God, why have you forsaken me? If he can forsake Jesus, why not me? I entered into a spiritual crisis that lasted from February of this year all the way up until 11:30 a.m. today. And I'm not joking. I stopped praying. I stopped reading the Bible. When COVID started, I felt extremely alone. All of my Christian brothers and sisters were leaning into him. And I couldn't. And I thought, why did you go dark on me? Why did you let this person destroy our relationship? I don't care about my money. I don't care about a movie. I don't care about my book. Honestly, I could care nothing about these earthly things. But God, I was begging you to stand by me, to answer me, to walk with me. And you didn't. I read the book of Job a million times. I could pick out scripture and I could tear it apart. My faith, my spiritual gifting, it was like this roaring fire 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2 years ago. It was a roaring fire, and it was like someone had dumped a whole bunch of water on it, and it was just smoking, and the fire was out. And it was a dark, dark place. But faith was my spiritual gifting. And so there was one little ember burning still. There was no fire, but there was one glowing red ember at the bottom of that smoking pit. children. I read a few devotionals here and there. I was trying so hard. I just didn't believe anything anymore. And then I went to bed last night. I didn't really know how that talk was going to end. Honestly, because it's hope. I had none. And I really didn't know how to end this talk. I went to bed last night. I laid in the bed and I didn't sleep. Not a single second. I just tried to listen for God. And there was nothing. And I was reminded of Mother Teresa. I don't know if you know her story. I didn't know much about it, but at 3 a.m. you can Google lots of things. And apparently, after she got the call to go serve in the slums, and she went, she never heard from God again for the rest of her life. And she wrote journals and journals about her doubts and about the darkness of the silence of God. And I thought, okay, I'm not comparing myself to Mother Teresa. Please do not hear that when you walk out of the door. But I thought, yeah, I'm there. How do you walk through that? So I got out of bed, and by 11:30 I thought, okay, I should probably shower. So I got in the shower, and a lot of times that's where I do hear God. I hadn't, not for the past year and a half. I haven't heard from him. I got in the shower today at 11:30, and I said, God, are you there? And he said, I'm right here. He said, I'm right here. And I cried and cried and cried, and I got out of the shower. And I went to look at the scar that I still have on my stomach from that flagpole that gutted me at age 7. The scar isn't gone. The scar's gone. I've had that scar my whole life. And when I got out of the shower this morning at 11:30 and looked for it, it was gone. I have seen that scar 100,000 times, and I cannot find it today. And that's a miracle. And the message that God was telling me was, I am making you perfect. I am making you perfect. And if it means silence, when you already know me, you know my character, you know my will, then that's okay. I'm making